I'm here to introduce Mark Gura. Mark Gura is the president of the Atheist Alliance of America and the president of the nonprofit association of Mindfulness, Meditation, and Secular Buddhism. He's also the president of iSecularBuddhist.com. So that's iSecularBuddhist.com. Mark has had over 20 years' experience in practicing mindfulness and meditation and has traveled to more than 80 countries to study religion. His books include Atheist Meditation, Atheist Spirituality, and Exploring Your Life, and he hosts the iSecularBuddhist.com podcast, so I hope you look into that. Mark seeks to eliminate dogma and indoctrination by empowering individuals to learn evidence-based meditation techniques and to encourage science, reason, critical thinking, and humanism. And the thing that I'd like to add is that Mark has been extremely generous to the humanist community. He has traveled to give talks for free. He has shared everything he's known very generously with our community. And I don't want these people to go unnoticed or unrecognized for studying and learning and sharing everything they've discovered with us. So please help me welcome Mark Gura.
Thank you so, so much, Debbie. Thank you so much. Thank you, Jennifer, Nicole. Everyone here, and it's interesting, during this conference, I had a chance to talk to some of you, and we've laughed together, we've talked about the intricacies of life, and in some cases, we've even cried together. I think this is a special group, because we're not just non-theists. Everyone here is interested in doing good, right? And everyone here wants to make a difference in their life, truly wants to make a difference. We want to make this life count. We don't want it just to be a brief flash that goes unnoticed. We want to make a difference. And we also want to combat the indoctrination that's out there. We want to make the world a better place. And we want personal transformation in many cases, too. And so we have a very special opportunity. The Secular Buddhist Reformation is an opportunity for this. Secular Buddhism eliminates the need for religion, dogma, and superstition in traditional Buddhism, but it also adds an element to humanism that we can pull from that's secular, that's humanistic. And we have an opportunity to change an entire religion from within, the fourth largest religion in the world. And when we change a religion, we dispel indoctrination. We change voting patterns, and we create more humanists and skeptics. Now, how many of you have heard something like this? I was brought up Christian. You know, I follow the faith of my ancestors. My family's always been Muslim or Hindu or Buddhist or whatever. And then, you know, you reflect to yourself, why did these ancestors choose this religion? And, you know, we think about what's happened in the world. And we think about, how does religion even get chosen onto a person? Or is it a product of geographical indoctrination, conquest, colonization, isolation, indoctrination? So some people, some of us, we don't just believe, we test and corroborate information. Without falsifiable, testable, replicable evidence, we don't consider extraordinary claims, and we certainly don't believe them, right? Well, Buddhists are no exception. Some people examine their religious beliefs and are skeptical about their religion. So some Buddhists actually do that too, and they're supposed to, because within Buddhism, one of the tenets is to question, is to know the truth, is to seek the truth, to know for yourself. So we call Buddhists who question their religion, who are secular, we call them secular Buddhists. And secular Buddhists are humanists. They don't believe in gods, they don't believe in gurus, and they don't believe in the supernatural. So common reasons why a traditional Buddhist, not a secular Buddhist, a traditional, everyday, normal Buddhist from some other Buddhist camp that's been around 2,500 years, why would that Buddhist question Buddhism? A lot of us think, wow, Buddhism has a good name. A lot of us think, oh, Buddhism's great. But if you really look into Buddhism deeply, a lot of these traditional Buddhist camps have some things that we will not agree with. They have animistic beliefs. They believe in some sort of a supernatural element that survives this life. They believe in spirits and ghosts and gods with a small g. Generally, they also believe that men are superior to women. Yeah, and all these things are very well hidden. A lot of times you'll go to a meditation center or an organization that's Buddhist, and they gloss that over, they hide it. But when you get into the deeper echelons of the leadership of these organizations, these are their core principles that come from ancient times, from 2,500 years ago, before Christianity was even around. Now, I argue that that's not the core of Buddhism, and I'll talk about that in a second. Also, they revere monks. They believe that monks are above everyone else for making that commitment. Also, you know, I've talked about the karma rebirth thing. And in a lot of cases, they're very devotional and faith-based and dogmatic. Does that sound like humanism? Come on. So is traditional Buddhism a religion? Well, I like to define religion as any organized system of beliefs about the cause, nature, and purpose of existence that has a core concept that depends on the supernatural. Now, some of the things that I've just mentioned are supernatural. So you might say, well, then what about football? Is that a religion? What about politics? You know, what about science? You know, science gets accused of being a religion. I mean, if something's ritualistic, if something, you know, if we do something a lot, does that make it a religion? I say no. What makes things a religion is the supernatural component. Otherwise, the Scouts would be a religion, or, you know, politics would be a religion. So is secular Buddhism a religion? We know traditional Buddhism is a religion. Secular Buddhism, no belief in the supernatural, no belief in gods, no reliance on gurus. So why use the term secular Buddhism? Why not just call it humanism or something like that, right? Because it's already a thing. Secular Buddhism is already a thing. And by the way, you're part of its history right now, because this is the first time in 77 years that the American Humanist Association has brought forth a presentation about secular Buddhism. This is the first time. You are part of a historic wave. This is really cool. We're here together doing this. But it's already a thing. And also, secular Buddhism, using that term, gives humanism, the rightful leverage to reform the superstition, to reform this religion. It gives you the leverage. And so let's talk about what it is, right? A person may rightfully self-identify as a secular Buddhist if you practice some sort of a Buddhist meditation in a secular way. Now, you might say, oh, that's just meditation. Why don't I just call myself a meditator? Because in Buddhism, meditation is the most important thing. It's the core thing that there is. Granted, a lot of Buddhist leaders don't allow their congregations to meditate. They keep that for themselves. But the fact is that's a core principle in Buddhism. So if you meditate using some sort of a secular Buddhist system, such as mindfulness meditation, you can rightfully call yourself a secular Buddhist. If you subscribe to Buddhist ethics in any way that are secular, you can rightfully call yourself a secular Buddhist. If you subscribe or are informed by Buddhist philosophy in any way, you can rightfully call yourself a secular Buddhist. Now, how does secular Buddhism, humanism, atheism, skepticism, all that stuff fit in, right? I kind of liken skepticism to a gateway drug, right? You know, we become skeptical, and then we're kind of like, hey, wait a minute, I'm an atheist. Wow, cool. So what do I do with that, right? You know, if you really believe and strive to live an ethical and personally fulfilling life for the greater good of humanity, you're going to be in this room, hopefully, right? And you're going to be a humanist, not just an atheist, also an atheist, but also a humanist. And then if you utilize some sort of Buddhist system, whether it's meditation, philosophy, or ethics, you can rightfully call yourself a secular Buddhist, but you're still a humanist. Now, what about the Buddha? You know, what's this Buddha thing? Buddhism, Buddhism, Buddha, you know? Who was the Buddha? Who is this character? Guy, a regular individual that lived 2,500 years ago that's been given all kinds of mythological powers over the centuries, right? But he lived 2,500 years ago. He was a Hindu prince or chieftain, and he led a very privileged life. At some point, he left his privileged life to seek answers, to figure out, you know, why he's suffering, why people are suffering, what's going on. And he rejected Hinduism. He studied with several Hindu teachers of the day. He rejected Hinduism and developed some meditation techniques. The cornerstone of what he developed was the meditation. He taught it to like five people, and now we have more than 500 million Buddhists in the world, the fourth largest religion. And throughout most of the rest of his life, he traveled and taught and helped people. He may have been one of the first documented humanists in history, maybe. Now, what was he all about? Like, what was the core of what he wanted to do? His primary directive was, don't worship gods. Sound familiar? That's us, right? Meditate and learn inner peace. In other words, don't suffer unnecessarily. Learn how not to suffer unnecessarily. And learn how to have that power from within so you're not attached to anything external and you don't have to rely on crutches. So imagine what a message this was 2,500 years ago. Think about 2,500 years ago. Theism reigned. And polytheism reigned. You know, you had all these, the ancient Egyptians, the ancient Romans, the ancient Hindus, all these gods. And the main directive, and you've all seen those statues, you know, people sitting there begging, you know, God, please help. Right? All these things. And here's this guy, and he's saying, don't worship the gods. Don't worship the gods. Just learn inner peace. Be happy in this life, in the now. Internally. So as you can imagine, that was pretty controversial. And so after he died, these priests were freaking out. They were like, oh man, he's just taking all our followers. What do we do about this Buddha character? Well, I know, let's make him a god in our pantheon. So then if someone wants Buddha, we can just tell him to come to our temple. So that's how religion started to kind of change Buddhism. The point of this slide and what I'm talking about here is since then, until now, everywhere that Buddhism went, it changed with the culture and the times. So when Buddhism went to Tibet, it mixed with the Tibetan original religion, which was Bon, very theistic, polytheistic type of religion. When Buddhism went to Burma, it changed. When it went to Thailand, it changed. When it went to Sri Lanka, it changed. And when it came to the United States, now, in our present times, it's now changing again because it's taking on our culture and our system, but leaving the core primary directive. So secular Buddhism is just another thing that Buddhism has done since the beginning of time. So it's not really a new thing. It's just a continuation of what Buddhism has always done. But now we're doing it. We're the ones that are defining what secular Buddhism is, and we're changing the fourth religion in the world in this way. You all, each one of you can impact a religion. So Buddhism has, as of 2010, that was, you know, almost 10 years ago, 500 million people, 7% of the world population, fourth largest religion of the world. And how many secular Buddhists are there? We don't know, but it's growing, it's starting, this is the beginning. So what's secular Buddhism in a nutshell? It's traditional Buddhism minus the gods, gurus, pseudoscience, and supernatural. It only utilizes beliefs and practices that are consistent with and corroborated by science. And if you meditate, follow an ethical or philosophical system that stems from Buddhism, that's secular, you're a secular Buddhist. Now, meditation is arguably the most important aspect of Buddhism. And why? It's because it changes lives. It empowers people. It's changed my life, it's empowered me. And, you know, we've heard several talks now, you know, about, you know, what do we bring into humanism that doesn't make it just an empty shell? Like, what do we bring to humanism that will give people something that they're getting from religion right now? And, you know, the fact of the matter is, if we just keep it to surface level things and we don't introduce some sort of a deep psychological inner system into humanism, we won't be filling needs, because each one of us in our lives goes through travails and things that happen in our lives. And so this can be something that we can bring in that will help transform humanism in that way too. In other words, not transform humanism, but give humanism that extra edge. Because meditation curbs stress. It makes people feel inwardly strong and empowered. It helps people feel more compassionate, because when you're not feeling bad, you tend to be less bad out, you know, externally. So in other words, a lot of the times that we do bad things, that humans do bad things, it's because we're not feeling good inside, right? And then we kind of lash out. So when you utilize some kind of a system that releases the stress, curbs the stress, it makes you better. But for the longest time, you know, these things that I'm talking about, the humanist, the atheist community has thought, well, these are just subjective experiences. You know, what's the difference between that and what the religious people do, right? Well, first of all, these are secular subjective experiences, but they're not even just subjective. Now, because neuroscience has started to test meditation, secular meditation, we know based on studies that meditation does decrease stress. It does decrease depression, dissatisfaction, unproductive mental patterns, anxiety disorders, and addictions. But the neatest and weirdest thing about it all is meditation actually changes your brain physically. So based on more than 20 studies, British Columbia, the University of British Columbia found that there are certain brain areas that change. So for example, increase in tissue in the area of the brain that maintains attention and controlling impulses. Thicker tissue in the area responsible for attention control and body awareness. Stronger connections between various brain areas. Reduction in the region linked to negative emotions, sadness and anxiety. And a reduction in the activity in the regions responsible for pain, right? That's kind of cool. And that's what it actually looks like. So Thea talked about neuroplasticity. That's one way that we, you know, we have access to neuroplasticity all the time, but through meditation, you're actually actively working to change those brain areas physically. So now we know from a scientific point of, from an evidence-based point of view, that meditation works. It's not just some subjective experience like religion is in you know, the mythological part of religion. Now, I don't want to oversell meditation. It's not like a cure-all for everything. And I'm not going to go too in-depth about it. There are many books about it. But there are some dangers of meditation, too, that you need to be aware of. So one of the first dangers is that meditation now is on every corner. It's everywhere. Be very careful when you go to a meditation center, because a lot of them are pushing things that we disagree with. And the directive that they usually have is just to try to get you to ignore those things. And when you do and you start meditating, years go by, you just kind of wait, you know. And after a while, you know, those things get maybe normalized, or you introduce other people to those things. So it's important to understand meditation and really what it is. I have videos about this. I did a talk about it yesterday morning. So some of you saw that, but there are certain things you need to know about meditation, so please look into that. We don't have time today to talk about that. But the other dangers are meditation can release unprocessed anxiety, grief, fear, anger, emotional and mental blockages from past trauma, or maybe even made-up trauma, uncomfortable feelings and sensations. So the thing is if you're working with a really good teacher, technique, all these things can be alleviated, unless... The main thing about this is meditation is considered safe for healthy people. So if there are any mental things that you know, do talk to your physician if you have any doubts whatsoever. You know, you just want to be careful before getting into a meditation regime. So why is secular Buddhism needed? There are three basic reasons, three very main reasons. We're breaking religion's monopoly over psychological experiences. You know, religion has created a monopoly over these psychological experiences like meditation. And it's convinced people that when they're experiencing altered states of consciousness, that what's really happening is they're talking to gods or spirits or something like that. And we know that's not true. It's a psychological experience, but religion has monopolized that. Now, why does religion monopolize that? Why does religion do that? If you think about it, religion stands on four pillars. And these four pillars have existed since the beginning of time for religion, and they've empowered religion. The first pillar is theology. So theology is just a fancy word for supernaturally based worldview, right? It consists of some history, some psychology, some mythology, some rites and rituals. Well, we humanists don't need theology because we have science and reason. So we don't need that pillar, and we're crumbling that pillar that religion stands on. So boom, that pillar's gone. Religion has three pillars left. Altruism. For the longest time, religions convinced people that you cannot be a good person without religion. If you're not religious, you're bad. Well, we're dispelling that myth, right? I mean, Atheist Alliance of America, we help the homeless. All of you do great things. We can be good without God. So that pillar's gone. Religion can't claim that anymore. So altruism doesn't belong to religion anymore, right? So two more pillars left that religion stands on. Community. As many people have spoken during this conference, community is something that if you didn't have a religious community in the past, you were kind of screwed. You may have been burned at the stake if you weren't part of the community, right? So that's disappearing for religion because we're making our own communities. This is, you know, that's what we're doing here right now, right? We're together. So that pillar's gone. Religion has one pillar left, and that's what they call spirituality. And it's just a code word for a psychological experience that's an altered state of consciousness, which is really meditation. So that pillar is eroding. So secular Buddhism is the right thing to do too because it gives us proper attribution. It attributes the fact that this system does come from Buddhism. And so failing to self-identify as a secular Buddhist loses our leverage over transforming Buddhism. So we can self-identify however we want, but if we just say we're humanists and we meditate and we're not secular Buddhists, then immediately we don't have a say as to what Buddhism is or should be. And that loses our leverage over Buddhism. So why do we need leverage? Because of that monopoly that religion created, you know, those four pillars that it's standing on, that fourth pillar. So why should the humanist community help? Secular Buddhists are secular, they're humanists, many of them, not all of them. They need our help to transform traditional Buddhism. Secular Buddhists remind traditional Buddhists that rites, rituals, faith in God's gurus and the supernatural and the pseudoscience are unnecessary. And secular Buddhists are humanist voters. The challenge we face is that generally, secular Buddhists are ostracized not only by traditional Buddhists, but also disliked by Christians, of course, because it's a competing thing, Hindus and Muslims, but also rejected a lot of times by humanists and atheists. I mean, in the beginning, when I first got into this movement, before Sam Harris started to publish his books and stuff like that too, before my book came out, a lot of atheists and humanists were like, what the heck? The fact is once they understood what's going on, and I've showed this presentation to many, many very hardcore firebrand atheists, leaders, and stuff like that, and they finally understood and said, wow, this is something we should embrace. So, you know, secular Buddhism needs your help in this matter. There are 500 million Buddhists, and many don't realize that they're secular Buddhists, that they're humanists, and they're one of us. And if you, any way you look at it, there's a large percentage of the world out there that is actually theist. So any number that can help our numbers is great. So one last thing that I want to really leave you with that's a very important core component of this. Secular Buddhism is history in the making. This is a reformation, a historical event that school children will read about all over the world for as long as history is taught in classrooms. It's a reformation of an entire religion from within. And you're part of this. We are part of this. And this has never happened to Buddhism before, not in 2,500 years. This is the first time that science has been able to help reform a religion from the inside out. So our work is to find secular Buddhists and to let them know that they're fellow humanists, that they belong in our community. And by taking part in this reformation, you're helping to reform and change the fourth largest religion from within. and enacting a personal transformation as well. So what should you do? Go to iSecularBuddhist.org, continue to support the American Humanist Association, welcome secular Buddhists to the humanist community, and we're gonna have a book soon about secular Buddhism specifically that's gonna be coming out soon. And learn to meditate if you think that this can help be, you know, something transformative in your life. And above all, what I really want is your feedback and your ideas and your questions. So feel free to email me, get in touch with me, ask some questions. I don't know how much time we have left. We have a little bit of time? Great. Okay. So questions, and feel free to just really tell me what comes up for you about what we've talked about. Thank you.
In your presentation, you sort of warned us off from gurus. And another point, you said a teacher's okay. So I thought it'd be interesting to hear how you distinguish between a guru and a teacher.
Yeah, great question. The way I see it is a teacher is a guide, you know, someone who helps you. A guru is someone that tells you to jump off a roof and you just say when. So if someone has that much power over you, run. John.
Yeah. Hi, Mark. Thanks for your talk, and thanks for all you do.
Thank you.
Many of us that were in the AHA are attracted to Buddhism, Humanism, and Unitarian Universalism. We're right. Sort of a boo-hoo you use, you know. sometimes what bothers me a little bit is the term secular in terms of defining religion and secular in terms of each other, you know. In many ways, it's a false dichotomy. Turkey, for example, up until recently, now it's worse, was both one of the most secular countries in the world and one of the most religious at the same time. So we've got to be really careful we don't put ourselves into a category that people misunderstand. Why not just call it humanistic Buddhism?
Yeah, you know, this name secular Buddhism for some reason has stuck. You know, is it my favorite word? Not really. It's just kind of like what it's called. But I think you're right, John. I think the name's gonna change as we come up with better names. It's gonna transform. I mean, the only thing that I worry about is fragmenting, you know, the group of secular Buddhists or whatever you want to call them, and then, you know, creating what we have in, you know, in atheism today, which is named, you know, different name. And in some cases, people don't even know who's who or what's what. I love the concept of unity and us uniting and being stronger together. So, I don't, you know. Hopefully we'll find a cooler name, and you know, that might be it. Yes, sir.
I always thought Buddhism was really a neat religion or whatever. But what the hell's going on with them killing all the Muslims and kicking them out of the country? What's that about?
Yeah, well, traditional Buddhism is a religion, you know. I'll argue with people about that. And as any other religion, you know, it has its assets. And, you know, assets include land. So when other religions try to encroach on that land, a war starts. So that's what's happening. It's a war over land, just like religion has done since the beginning of religion.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, I'm going to play a little bit of a devil's advocate.
Yay,
here.
We got the devil here.
Devil is in the house.
I knew it. You're all Satanist.
I am really struggling to understand what you mean by the concept of Buddhism. I don't understand, and you mentioned this, why it isn't just humanism with meditation. Why infiltrate Buddhism? I don't see a connection to the word Buddhism and the Buddha. All I hear is meditation and humanism, and I don't see any difference.
Got it. Yeah. Well, would you feel sad like I do if you saw, you know, a Buddhist who had been indoctrinated all their lives into Buddhism and was really one of us and didn't know it?
But that's different. I think what you're advocating for is basically humanism and learn how to meditate. I don't see the connection to Buddhism. What about a poor Muslim or a poor Jew or a poor Christian who is not sure what they're doing? I mean, and there are humanistic Jews and I think that there are Muslims who are atheistic now, but I just don't see, aside from the meditation aspect, and I'm just having trouble wrapping my mind around that.
Yeah, let's understand. Well, two aspects to that, right? Like, so first of all, if I see a Buddhist that's really a humanist, I can say, hey, you're a fellow humanist, but you're also a secular Buddhist. And they much more relate to that than just cutting off all their ties to Buddhism. Just like, you know, someone who's Jewish, who loves the traditions, but doesn't believe in the supernaturalism, they don't just stop calling themselves Jewish, they say, I'm a secular Jew, right? And that's very, you know, that's legitimate, because they grew up with a certain tradition that they enjoy, but they don't believe in the supernatural. So that's kind of what we're doing here. You know, there are ex-Buddhists as well, and ex-Buddhists would be someone that just doesn't like anything about Buddhism at all, and they're just like, I'm leaving, you know? Like ex-Muslims in some cases. But some Buddhists who like something about Buddhism can self-identify, and that's up to each individual. Sorry, go ahead.
I just wondered if you wanted to touch on the expansion of meditation into other areas by other names, relaxation techniques, medical field using biofeedback.
Oh, sure.
And self hypnosis for problem solving. And then the second question is, in the lost years of Jesus, there's some people that have proposed that he went and studied Eastern philosophies, perhaps Buddhism, and brought those back. And so that.
Yeah, no, I take those as great comments. I think you said it. I think you said it very well with both of those things.
Mark, thank you for your enthusiastic presentation. When you talk about, you made the comparison to secular Judaism, and one difference I see is that people who are adherents of secular Judaism came from a Jewish tradition. And I think if somebody were to say, look, there are a lot of people who are Jews who are really humanists, so everybody should become secular Jews and let's infiltrate Judaism and try to make that a more secular thing. Why isn't what you're advocating the same thing? I mean, there are secularists in all religion.
Well, Judaism has done a great job, you know, like all by itself. We don't even need to help it, you know, like for some reason, you know, secular Jews have just found one another and have said, hey, you know, I don't know why it happens with Buddhism that people don't, a lot of traditional Buddhists don't even realize that secular Buddhism exists. That blows me away, you know. So most of the work that we're going to be doing next is going into Buddhist communities and helping them realize that they're secular Buddhists. So I need your help with that, you know, because just imagine how many more people we can bring into our camp. You know, like, think of all the Asian countries. Do we have one person that's of Asian descent here right now? One person. So, you know, think about all the people from Asia that don't know about secular Buddhism that should be here, that have that tradition, that background, you know? So, yeah. Jennifer.
Okay, this is the last question.
Mark, thank you for that talk. Are you aware of the book, I think it's Robert Wright, the new book, Why Buddhism is True? Have you seen that one?
I haven't read it.
So, and I think he comes from a philosophical and psychological background. So he must find something appealing in this other than meditation. Like there's some analysis that the Buddha had in terms of human psychology. And you mentioned philosophy. So would you add something like that, that Buddhism has some sort of analysis of the human condition that you find to be accurate?
Yeah, I think so. You know, the reason I say meditation is a core principle in Buddhism is because everything comes from the meditation. And then the philosophy, psychology, and ethics describe the meditation, describe the path of the meditation in life, describe the effects of the meditation on the psychology of a person and on the behavior and ethics of a person. So all these other fields stem from the meditation. And even when you talk to monks that have dedicated their lives to traditional Buddhism, they will usually specialize in one of these three fields, either the meditation, the psychology, or the ethics. So yeah, or the philosophy. I call it philosophy, but I include in the philosophy the psychology. So yeah, Buddhism does have a lot of statements about the psychological nature of humanity within its philosophy. The reason I don't call it psychology per se, even though traditional Buddhists do, is because it's not really, that psychology is not corroborated by science yet or right now. So, you know, I don't want to give it that extra gravitas of calling it psychology, so I call it a philosophy. But you're very right, it belongs in that sphere as well.
Well, thank you so much, Mark. Really appreciate the talk. We're going to take a 10-minute break, and we'll start promptly at 10 o'clock.